All right, welcome to the video. We're going to cover a lot of territory here, maybe some territory I'm not even aware of yet. And before we get started, we're just going to remind ourselves of the great importance to be in a mood that can withstand great breakthroughs, because that's the whole purpose of doing this, is actually we're going to have great breakthroughs. We have to. And this mood is a sort of relaxed, quiet, non-disputive, argumentative, non-emotionalized, non-analytical, intellectual, humble mood. We know we have a severe problem. We have a severe continuity problem. So we're here because we have a severe problem. And there's no shame in having the severe continuity problem. That just means that we're extremely creative. And the only mistake we made was that we were creative in a way of trying to change what we really are, which is impossible. And the creativity in trying to do that has generated this continuity problem, because we've been pretending that we're so unhappy, really, that unhappiness is our natural state. That's what we've been pretending for so long through our creativity, that the idea of setting down the attempt to change what we are, to fail to be what we are, and to experience true happiness, it seems like, wow, too beyond our comprehension, overwhelming. It seems overwhelming to us. That's what I mean by continuity problem. So we definitely have an incredibly severe continuity problem that's holding up everything. It's blocking everything. And it keeps our suffering going. So we humbly pay attention. Our attention should be humble attention, all ears, realizing that we need to evaporate this continuity fear as much as possible. And to remain in this observant, watchful, listening state, try to let your thoughts calm down, all calm down, is the best way to evaporate the continuity fear. So we remind ourselves that the fact that I am not a body, I am free. I am as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am as God created me, which is spirit, which is like a wisp of wind, as free as the breeze. Free as the breeze, absolutely. I am not a body, I am free. I am as God created me. And we relax our mind, we release our thoughts, and we let them go. We relax our minds, we release our thoughts, and we let them go, and we don't chase after them. We don't ask them back either, because all thoughts are definitions of what we are. And what we are is freedom itself, which is undefinable, right? Is undefinable. Pure freedom, how can you define what it is? How do you delineate? Okay, this is the boundary, this is the delineation, this is the definition. Define means to delineate. What we are is undefined. So thoughts are all definitions which create values of what we believe. We need this to be what we are, to be happy. And so when we think, we're delineating, we're creating values of what we are, which is really creating our own death, own sense that if we don't have that, we won't be complete. But pure freedom is inherently complete in itself. It's undefined, true, pure completion, inherently complete. So we're going to relax our minds, release our thoughts, and let them go. We don't need them to know what we are. Okay, so I've noticed that there's about a core group of viewers, that 30 to 40 viewers that are always watching the videos. So instead of trying to dumb down the videos to try to attract, you know, more viewers, I'm going to keep the content of the videos, you know, very high as possible, so that those key viewers can get the best help and best information and best experience possible. So I will continue on in this way, and not worry if the view count is 30 to 40. It is what it is. And so want to reach those 40 key viewers as much as possible. Now, what about the future? We know that forecasts, for instance, today weather forecast, I had this weather forecast, I wanted to go somewhere, and the weather forecast said, it looks pretty nice. And I said, okay, great. So I went there, it was terrible. It was cold and windy and raw. Where I live, it was a beautiful day, but where I went to, you know, it was lousy. So the weather forecast was wrong. Because I pinpointed that place and it was wrong. Just a terrible day. So I turned around and went home. Just came. I said, forget it. Not going to spend any time there. It's inhospitable, very inhospitable. So what we want to know is the future hospitable or inhospitable? That's the question, right? For each one of us is trying to answer that question. Now, who is making the forecast of the future is the question. When you tune into all the sources of information on this planet, where is it coming from? Where is it coming from? Now, where it's coming from is going to influence what the forecast is going to be. A lot of people feel the future is very bright here. And some say, pros and cons. And then there's some who say it's going to be pretty nasty. And then there are those who say it's going to be very bad. So how do we look at the future? I say it's going to be inhospitable. This is my viewpoint. How inhospitable is always subject to, you know, question, right? How do we know for sure how inhospitable? But I think we know, for instance, today, I could tell the weather, I said, because I was just in this weather before, and I knew, oh boy, this is going to really batter me and wear me down. And it's no fun at all. No fun at all. So I just made the judgment call. I said, this is, I'm not going to have an hospitable time. No way. It's going to be a battle. So we can just look at this future in very simple terms. Is it going to be a battle for us, or is it going to be hospitable? Is the future going to be a situation where we're really, you know, going against the current, going against the wind in our face, strong wind in our face, just being, you know, buffeted this way and that? Or is it going to be a smooth, you know, love is there and feel, this is really hospitable, I really feel comfortable here. It's easy to weigh that. It's going to be either one or the other, right? Pretty much so. So the question we have, okay, what about the future? What about the future? Now, I've been digging into that my whole life. And I'm trying to get specifics for everybody. Now, what I got, made another effort yesterday, very big effort. And what I got back was, it's confidential. It's, you know, I can't get the info I want. And the reason why is it's confidential. Why it's confidential, I'm not sure. I can always theorize about it. But I'm not able to get exact specifics of you know, timelines, and just, you know, pin it down. Can't pin it down. That sort of information apparently is not being made. It's kind of being blocked from us. So, letting the male person clear out. However, where does that leave us? Where does that leave us? However, I have had it pointed out to me. Say, look here, look here, look here, look here. And an intelligent person can put two and two together and realize that what I've been shown in the past is a like a flash crash taking place in the world, sort of a global flash crash. And what I've been shown is that, how is this possible? How is it possible? It's very possible right now, because the overwhelming majority of all, for instance, transactions, like on stock transactions, in you know, most banking transactions, it's all being done by machines, by computers, and based on, you know, algorithms. It's all programmed. It's programmed trading, super fast trading, millions of a second, thousands of stocks being traded back and forth, trying to like just earn a penny, you know, just to catch that penny somewhere. And so people are pretty much out of the loop, actually, right now. And that is very worrisome, actually, because we do not know for sure what algorithms, how exactly they're going to behave when faced with all possible scenarios, right? There's no way. And there's already been one flash crash, and then they put in circuit breakers to try and prevent that. But they say that the technology is so far ahead of the ability to really know what's going on and to know for sure whether we're safe or not. We don't know. We really don't know at this point. And what about the wild card of malicious software? See, that thing. Or what about the plan of, for instance, a global consortium of multinational global companies, in which there is such a consortium, that have interlocking directorships and board of directors. They're very much interlocked. These huge multinational global corporations form actually a global power base, government, as it were, of their own, unelected, unaccountable in many, many, many ways. Now, what about them? They would like to see a global currency, wouldn't they? They would like to see all sorts of changes to this planet. They would like to see an homogenization of all people on the planet so they can predict make the consumers predictable. So all their metrics can be planned out in advance, and they can feel what? That the future is hospitable to them, right? Everybody aims at a hospitable future, okay? Let's not kid ourselves. So these global interlocking corporations are looking for their hospitable future, okay? Which means they have a plan for you and me and everybody on the planet. Now, what is to say that they don't have a plan to bring this about and are actually pressing that forward? Of course they are. Of course they are. Now, what I was shown years ago, I was shown there's a plan in a dream. It's an extremely complex plan, and there's no way I could describe the complexities. I don't even understand. I was aware how complex it is, and it is a computer software plan, actually. And it does have to do with the overall global financial structure and the corporate structure, and it does have to do with various countries, and it is something that has been planned out very meticulously ahead of time. And so from my standpoint, there is definitely a blueprint for how to bring about a future that is hospitable to these global corporations. That would essentially create a new world order of one currency, okay, throughout the whole planet. It would reorganize the entire banking to have a central bank. The whole world would have central bank. You would have there will be like global laws applying to all countries, especially with the economy and commerce, but filtering down so that there would be a set of laws for all countries of the world to abide by, a set of environmental standards, etc. On and on and on and on. It's planned for this centralized, bureaucratic, planetary governance to be imposed upon everybody without any vote at all, really, or at the point of a gun, actually. Because the gun is the economic recovery from a global flash crash. So there's no question that the capability for a global flash crash is there. Easy. If you fed the right algorithms for a flash crash into the machines, it would happen. It would happen. So it's very possible. Those who say, well, it's impossible, they don't know what they're talking about. Actually, the world is passing them by. It's actually pretty much a piece of cake to actually pull it off. The issue is the will to do it. The will to do it. Now, do these multinationals, corporations, in a lot of countries, well, for one thing, there is a tremendous tension in the world over the United States, U.S. dollars being the default currency. And there's for buying oil, just it's the global default currency, right? So other countries are trying to change that. So there may be a consortium of countries, along with the corporations, who decide that they're going to now make this move and crash the dollar, crash the financial metrics of the whole planet to bring this about. It could very well happen. I don't have a date on it. I've been trying to pin things down exactly, but again, that's confidential. I'm not being given those specifics at all. I'm saying that everything, in a general sense, what I have gotten is there is going to be a flash crash at some point. Now, it's possible we could pull back from the edge of that. It's possible. But fairly unlikely the way things seem to be going. Because there are other plans afoot for the future. Remember, everybody wants to make the future hospitable to them. With one exception, and those are the enlightened ones, who have realized that the now is what is truly hospitable, and that time is make-believe, actually. It's all make-believe. It's all make-believe. So they have realized the inherent hospitality of reality and the inherent inhospitality of the make-believe hypothetical scenario of time, space, and form. Okay, appearance and form in time space. That's all make-believe. It's all a dream. It's make-believe. It's hypothetical. So they have a very different outlook on the situation. So there is that joker in the deck, the enlightened ones. Now, what do the enlightened ones tell us? What they say is that spirit decided on an adventurous whim, an impulsive adventurous whim, saying, hey, you know how sometimes we could be impulsive? Yes, spirit had this whim, like, you know what? I want to create separately from God. I want to be my own prime creator. I don't want to just extend the will of God in one seamless creation. I want to create a different creation. It's different than reality, God's creation. So I want to be separate from reality, separate from God, separate from the will of God, which is impossible. And we have to put up with the leaf blowers now. It's Wednesday. Sorry about that. Hopefully you can still hear me. I'll get a little closer here. So, we imagine that we can create separate from God. Well, this brought about an inherent, inescapable sense of conflict, because we're trying to be separate from God. We believe we're separate, except we're not. And so in order to experience this desire of ours to be separate, that has to include the sense of conflict. Because God is not allowing us to be separate. So we feel as if we're in conflict with God, not separate, but in conflict. And this feels wrong to us. Feels wrong. Something isn't right. Sense of guilt. I mean, they've got this uneasy, conflicted feeling. Like, I believe I'm separate, except I don't think I am separate. You know, there's an inner conflict. Inner conflict arises. Now, what we do in order to try to experience our idea is to displace this sense of conflict elsewhere and say it's coming, it's not coming between us and God, which if we saw it like that, we'd realize, I need to set down this crazy idea. I cannot be separate from God. So what we did was we imagined time, space, and form. And we said the conflict is coming from there, that there's a conflict within time, space, and form, bodies. That bodies are conflicting with one another, that form conflicts with one another, that the past and the future conflict. The conflict is there, not spirit with God, but bodies with bodies. So we have invented this device to actually give us something to displace the feeling of guilt, conflict guilt, displace it onto this prop we have made. Imagine, we're imagining. Just a second, I'm gonna let this roof blower calm down. All right, it's died down a little bit. Maybe that's a sign of what the future is going to be like, actually. Very turbulent and very inhospitable. Again, we all want a future that's hospitable, so except for the enlightened ones. So, in the pursuit of hospitable future, we need to take into account what this world really is. It's really a device for displacement. It's a displacement device where we're able to, we think that, here is the conflict. So we have conflict here in the world between people. Now the idea is for people to see the sense of this inner sense of guilt, wrongness coming from somebody doing something to some other body to harm it, to harm its happiness. And we say that's a sin, that's sinful, and we feel guilty about it. So when we get caught up in this, the belief that we can harm one another, against their will, when we get caught up in this belief, then we're able to displace this inner sense of guilt towards God, trying to separate from God, onto this whole scenario here of the world and bodies and people. And we think that, we're sinful, we're guilty because we did something to someone else that's wrong, or they did something to us that is we didn't want to have happen. Now what Jesus tells us is that that's totally impossible for anything to happen to spirit that isn't by choice. So, and you might say, wait a minute. What about murder and rape and all these terrible things that happen? According to Jesus, nothing whatsoever can ever possibly happen if there were not an agreement between the parties on the level of spirit, an agreement to experience this. So he said there's no sin and there's no, therefore no guilt at this level of bodies and appearances whatsoever. It's totally impossible. Now we might say, wait a minute. That's hard to believe, isn't it? However, keep in mind that we, in trying to be separate from God, create separately from God, this gives us a sense of an enormous conflict with God, even though God is not conflicted with us, because what we're trying to do is impossible. From our standpoint, we feel that God must be in conflict with us severely. And this feeling, it is so bothersome to us, so incredibly bothersome to us, that the desire to displace it and project it onto some other source other than God is so extreme and severe that we are willing, very willing, to use any and all devices of body attacking another body to make it seem that this is where the conflict is coming from, this is where the guilt is coming from. So of course, we have mayhem here. Raping and pillaging and mayhem and atrocities of all sorts, both gross and subtle, You know, you can go embezzlement, all white collar crime, flash crash, you know, all that stuff is an agree. There's agreement to, yes, this is what we need to do, because that's going to get rid of this sense of terrible sense of guilt we have. So it's like we promote guilt, the idea of guilt and sin between bodies, in order to try and displace this, the feeling of severe guilt towards God that we have, onto bodies, people. You see, and so it seems to turn our attention away from the real source of the situation, and then therefore we're able to keep on with the idea of creating separately. We're able to keep on thinking that we can somehow accomplish this, but the price we're paying is this. Agreements that we make to you know, engage in conduct which seems to cause bodies all sorts of problems, which of course it does, but that doesn't mean that there wasn't a spiritual agreement. You see, sure, bodies are die all the time from attacks, but what Jesus says is there was an agreement to act out this scenario at the level of spirit. There's an agreement to act out this scenario using bodies, which are not what we are at all. See, we're not bodies at all. Bodies are a device, a displacement device we're using, so we can displace and guilt and see it where it's not, so we can continue to entertain this idea of creating separately from God. Okay, this is the basic gist of what the enlightened ones have shared with me, and this is how I see it. I'm simpatico with this viewpoint, because reason has shown me that this is accurate. So it doesn't disturb me when I hear this. It is a wow, like wow, for sure. It's like, wow, that's heavy stuff. But I'm not, like, you know, fearful and fighting against it. Now, there's the wild card is the continuity problem. Because even when we see all this, we say, yeah. Still, we say, whoa, I don't want to set it down because I'm afraid I'm going to be overwhelmed with happiness. Unbearable happiness, you know. So, and in the times that I have momentarily set it down, I felt this growing sense of almost unbearable, overwhelming happiness, just incomprehensible happiness. And I said, wow. That's kind of difficult to feel that here in this world, because people would really have a hard time understanding that. They really would, because from their standpoint, you know, sin and guilt among bodies is gospel truth from their standpoint. It's a very useful lie is what it actually is. Now, how do we manage to keep ourselves believing that we're bodies when we are not? We're spirit, free as a breeze, like a wisp of wind. We try to define what we are. We try to define what we are. In reality, is undefined, as I've said before. Undefined happiness, undefined freedom. Freedom is undefined by very nature. If you define it, you're not free. You say, well, you can do this, but you can't do this. It's we're undefined. What we try to do is define an identity, which means is that we're not really free. So we've made all these definitions of what we are. And definitions mean delineation. Delineation means boundaries. Boundaries mean form. Form means surface, superficial. It means neglecting the content. So what we do as a world is to focus on form. Focus on form. This is called materialism, focusing on form. Now, when a world is focusing very heavily on form and trying to find beautiful form and trying to be attached to beautiful forms of bodies especially, but all types of form, but especially bodies, we would say that the world is in a very severe crisis, headed towards disaster, because there's a severe feeling of a need to project, to displace the sense of conflict with God onto bodies and to act out that conflict there, so as to believe that's where it's coming from. You see, when the planet or people's was a black bumblebee buzzing around here. When a planet or people's decide to repent and say, yes, God, I do have a sense of conflict with you because I was trying to create separately, but I'd like to set that crazy idea down, then there's not so much need to project conflict onto bodies, right? Because you see conflict where the origin of it, and you realize it's easily healed by the resolution of a continuity problem through the vision of oneness. And so you don't need to emphasize beautiful bodies, beautiful form so much. And so in such a situation, you see people dressing kind of plain, plainish. You know, they dress plain. They're not so obsessed about their appearance. They might, you know, they keep things neat and clean, but simple. Neat, clean, simple, basic. And there have been times in this world where it's like that. For instance, the Puritans coming over to America, that Puritan ethic, they're very, you know, strict sumptuary laws, what people, clothes they wore, how the appearance that, you know, you gave, de-emphasizing form, de-emphasizing the superficial, how the form of the body, how it looks. Whereas now we're at the opposite pole of that from Puritanism. I mean, the whole ideal of Puritanism has been under tremendous attack and assault on this planet, and demonization of it, as if it's somehow holding humanity back from its potential, meaning it's holding it back from potential of focusing on the superficial form of bodies and things, as if that's going to solve our problems. We just need it, as if doubling down on displacing the feeling of guilt onto bodies and seeing our identity as bodies. We need, in order to believe it all, we got to believe our identity is bodies. In order to do that, we have to delineate and define and try to make bodies seem attractive, you know, to us. As if doubling down on that somehow would succeed. It doesn't. Of course, it's folly. And to see all these, you know, beautiful body forms engaged in conflict with one another directs our attention even more so to the conflict among bodies, thinking that that's where our guilt is, instead of vis-a-vis God and our desire to create separately, have a separate creation. So we are at a time in this world where there is this unprecedented emphasis on form. I was in the drugstore today. I needed to accompany someone there. We happened to be walking through the cosmetic section of this drugstore. And I was just like, wow. Looking at all the pictures of the advertising, the cosmetics and everything, it's just like unbelievable. You know, just like, whoa. It brings home, and I was looking, I was able to look at the whole world today in the sense of, okay, where's the emphasis right now? And you can just see, there's this overwhelming emphasis on form right now. Overwhelming emphasis on body form, body appearance, body beauty, the body beautiful. It's all about the body now. That's a really extreme, extreme red flag for the world. So, we can get into some heavy talk about this. Which I have in the past also. Or we can kind of give an outline of a situation. But what to do about the situation? You know, you're aware of it. It's like, wow. So it means the future is very problematic. Because it's giving every indication of setting up for a severe conflict between bodies. The more we identify with bodies, the more conflict there is. Now, when in Rome, do as Romans do. So nobody's asking anyone to wear sackcloth. They walk around barefoot and starving, homeless, and unshaven, unkempt, and all that. No one's asking that at all. It's an attitude. It's an attitude. It's really an attitude. And it's an awareness. So you can still be presentable, a neat, clean, presentable. All right, there's no problem with that. But deglamorize it as much as possible. And the attitude is what is important. Where you don't pay attention, you know, to those who are merely pressing superficiality. Don't pay attention to them. That's what I do. I don't pay any attention. Just forget it. I know what you're up to. I know what you're up to. And pay attention to those who are promoting depth and content and clarity. That's what you do. That's what you do in such a situation. As we're in right now. Now there's a blueprint. One moment, here comes a leaf blower again. Silence. Beautiful. Let's keep in mind that almost every image you see in television, magazines, has been severely manipulated. For instance, magazines, there's not a single model that appears in magazines, almost none, let's say, that has not had all sorts of digital retouching done on the situation. There's enormous, you know, industry of retouching everything. This has been going on since the beginning of photography, actually, retouching. The movies have always done that to make the stars and starlets appear to be these flawless forms that we want to identify with and as our ideals, right? Those are role models. Yes, I want to focus my life on having a flawless form, you know, that kind of thing. And the magazines, the images, the models, the advertising that we get, it is extraordinarily deceptive. And this is part of a blueprint to turn the attention of the world to form and away from content. We have these, what I call the city girls, S-I-D-D-I, the city. City means spiritual powers. It's really the power to manipulate mirages, manipulate illusions, magic type of magical stuff, where it is able to give the appearance of sort of flawless form. The form seems so fresh and dewy and flawless. And the city girls have been working with this planet, and there are more to come. We might call them quote-unquote goddesses that appear in this world to promote the cult of form here. Promote the cult of form, which is the all about us then being willing to believe that that's what we are. And that therefore the conflicts in this world between bodies, between forms, that's the real conflict. And the conflict with God is an imaginary conflict. The spiritual conflict, we say, well, that's imaginary, I'm not spirit, I'm body. So it's body conflict, that's where the conflict is. You see, so the attempt to make form, to this cult of form, is to try to get us, spirit, to keep identifying more and more and more with form. Defining and valuing form. That's what it's all about. Defining and valuing form as what spirit is. So we have these city girls who, you know, the whole celebrity culture is all about this too. The entire celebrity culture, the whole Hollywood culture, all of that. It's the advertising culture. It's a cult of the body, of form. Designed again to provide a more realistic reason, excuse to displace this sense of guilt over the conflict we have with God. But it doesn't solve anything, does it? It doesn't solve anything. It just kicks the can down the road. And yet that's where we're at. That's where we're at here. it's very important to not get hooked into beautiful forms, okay, beautiful form. Because there seems to be an attraction. Anything beautiful, there seems to be an attraction, okay? However faint it is, you know, there's even a tiny subtle echo in form, beautiful form, of spirit. Tiny, tiny subtle echo. But we amplify that too much. Why? Continuity fear. Our fear of true happiness and true freedom, which our true freedom has for us, which is true happiness, is so strong that we are willing to embrace these idols, these body idols of this superficial form, airbrushed form, as it were, with paste smeared, you know, strategically on the eyes and face and the hair glossed and colored and made up, and clothing's hanging on the form, and then gold trinkets all over, and nice teeth, straight nice teeth, and those are idols, and we're willing to embrace these idols and value these idols as if we would be unhappy without them, rather than experience our freedom and our happiness, rather than resolve, set down this idea of wanting to create separately from God. We keep choosing to do that. So the real problem is this continuity problem. That's the real problem. How can we melt this resistance down to actually experiencing true happiness, not based on form, a formless happiness, as it were, a non-defined happiness? We see, we believe that it's impossible to have a non-defined happiness. In other words, happiness has to be, we believe, through sensory perception of some beautiful forms. And that's not true, because our true happiness is undefined, formless, undefined, has no value, is not related to appearance or form. And we can scarcely even imagine this. We're so used to sensory perception and what seems beautiful to sensory perception, which are superficial form. The happiness that we have, the true happiness is essence, content, essence, experience, actual experience, formless experience of essence. And again, this seems to be, you know, hard to even imagine. I can imagine it sometimes. You think if you try, you can sort of get a feel for it, actually. So the real way to proceed is to work on the continuity issue around happiness, and to do not try to wed it to beautiful form. Do not try to wed it to beautiful form, because that easily causes us to veer off then and be attracted to all the work that the city girls are doing, to, along with all their helpers, to bring about this cult of form, cult of body in the world. It's easy to get pulled down into that. It's happened to me, and it happened to anyone. If you try to emphasize beautiful form, especially beautiful bodies, even if they're spiritual, it's easy to get off track and head down the wrong road that way. So the safe way is to focus on continuity practice related to happiness is the easy, safe way to accomplish what we need to accomplish. Okay, so to that end, I'm going to present some of this type of practice here, so you can continue to get familiar with it. So just one moment and I'll share some of that. Okay, now the happiness, true happiness, we're going to say, what is it like? And we're going to say, what isn't it? You know, neti, 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 what isn't it? And we will find out that all the attributes that we think in the world of feeling and experience don't apply to happiness at all. For instance, happiness is unchurned. If you think like churning butter or something, always churning, changing, it's unchurned. There's no churning taking place. True happiness is unchurned. Real happiness is non-cycling. It's not being cycled. It's not cycles taking place. It is unmoving. That's why they say that true happiness is nirvana, without motion, without movement. It is unchanging. True happiness is unchanging. It is uncaused. There's no physical form cause of true happiness. Freedom is the true cause of happiness. We say it's uncaused. It is non-reactive. It is not reacting to any form whatsoever. No valuing. Does not react. Non-reactive. Non-choppy. It's not like a choppy ocean. It is non-blending. There's not all these like blenders. Not all being blended. There's nothing being blended. Non-blending. Non-folding. It's not being folded. There's no folds. Non-rotating. It's not rotation. There's non-whirling. It's not whirling around. True happiness is not whirling around. It's non-revolving. It's not revolving. It's non-circulating. It's not circulating somewhere. It's non-orbiting. It's true happiness is non-orbiting. Like all the planets, everything in the universe is orbiting. True happiness is not orbiting at all. There's no orbiting taking place. It is non-turning. It's not turning somewhere. It's non-tilting. It's not tilting. It's non-vortexing. There's no vortex. There's no black hole vortex in true happiness whatsoever. No, it's vortex free. It's non-rising. It's not rising up. It's non-setting. It's not setting down like the sun rising and the sun setting. It's totally there. It's non-spinning. It's not spinning. It's non-pulsing or pulsating. It's not pulsating, not this pulsating happiness. It's non-fluctuating, non-flickering, non-wavering. It's not wavering. It's non-swinging. It's not swinging back and forth. It's non-vibrating. There's no vibration to it. It's non-varying. It doesn't vary. It doesn't vary. Now it's this, now it's something else. Non-varying, non-veering. It doesn't go veer off somewhere. It's non-fragmenting. It's not being fragmented at all. It's non-alternating. It's not alternating this and then that, this, that. Non-heaving. There's not some heaving motion to pure happiness, true happiness, real happiness. It's not jerking, non-jerking. There's no jerk to it. There's non-quaking. There's no earthquakes in true happiness at all. There's no quakingness taking place whatsoever. There's no shivering. True happiness, it's not shivering like cold or shivering in fear, so no shivering. It's not twitching, there's no twitching. Pure happiness is, you won't see any twitching taking place. It's non-writhing, it's not writhing about, there's no writhing. It's not in the mud writhing around. It's non-throbbing, there's no throb to it. It is non-rippling, there's not all these ripples. Non-rippling, non-quavering, it's not quavering in any way. Quavering, non-fluttering, it's not fluttering about, it's non-bouncing, not bouncing like a ball, it's non-flickering, it's not flickering on and off, it's non-shaking, no shake, no tremor, non-tremoring, no tremor to it, non-burning, there's no flame, it's not burning, there's no combustion taking place, it is non-flaring, it doesn't suddenly flare up like a sun, it'll flare, there's no... True happiness is not like the sun with its flares, bursts, no non-bursting, non-burning, non-flaring, non-modifying, there's no modification taking place, there's non-modulating, it's not some modulation of a current, it's non-wobbling, there's no wobbliness to it, non-swirling, it's not swirling about, it's non-convulsing, no convulsions in it at all, it's non-jolting, there's no jolt to it. You know, it's not like you're experiencing something, there's a jolt. There's no jolt to it. It's unstirred. There's no stirring in true happiness. Non-frothing, non-foaming, there's none of that. It is undisturbed, no disturbance whatsoever in pure happiness. It is non-evaporating. It's not slowly and subtly evaporating and disappearing. No evaporation is taking place whatsoever. Neither is there any condensation, neither condensing nor evaporating. It is unrelated. It is not happiness in relation to anything. It is unsurging. There's no surge that is taking place. It is non-faint. It's not faint. It's not very faint. It's not feeble, non-feeble. There's no feebleness to it. There's no feebleness to it. It's non-fatigued. No faintness, no feebleness, no fatigue. It's unfatigued. No fatigue in our true happiness. It's non-sick. No sickness. Non-futured. It's not invested in some defined valued future. It's right now. It's non-past. Okay? It's not invested in some past. It's right now. It's non-influenced. There's no influence from the past or the future. There's nothing influencing true happiness at all. It is unfailing. No failure to it whatsoever. It is unshadowed. There's no shadows being cast at all on it or by it. Unshadowed, non-strobing. It's not strobing, like strobe lights, non-strobing. It's non-jarring. It's not a jarringness, no jarringness to it. Non-jittering, no jitter to it. It's not cracking. No cracks appearing. It's not breaking up. There's no breaking up. There's no crumbling taking place at all. No crumbling. No heating. It's not heating up. It's not decaying in any way. It's not deteriorating in any way. Undeteriorating, undecaying, unfreezing. There's no freeze. No constriction, unconstricted. There's no disintegration taking place whatsoever. No disintegration at all. Zero. It is not ripening up to be something else. It's not booming. There's no booms to it. There's no boom or bust to it. There's no booming. There's no stunning. You're not stunned by it. You're not shocked by it. No shocking taking place. It doesn't startle. There's no startling and unstartling. There's no startling. Like going around a corner. Oh, yeah, I'm startled. There's no startling to true happiness. There's no staggering. It doesn't stagger us in any way. It doesn't end. It's unending. It's unending happiness. It's no upsetting. There's no upset in it whatsoever. It's unseething. No seething quality to it. It's not working. It's not working on something. It's not turbulent. There's no turbulence whatsoever. True happiness is truly shatterproof. It is shatterproof. It cannot be shattered. There's no shattering taking place. There's no shearing taking place. There's no gusting. There's no gusts taking place in pure happiness. There's no cresting, like waves crest, all these crests. There's no crests to the happiness. It's all smooth, 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 equal. There's no snapping. It doesn't snap somewhere. It's not boisterous. There's no boisterousness, rowdiness, raucousness. There's none of that. It's not raucous or rowdy or boisterous. It's not chaotic. It's unchaotic. It's not arranging, frantically, arranging anything. Nothing needs to be arranged. Nothing needs to be harmonized. There's no harmonizing activity going on. There's no defining activity. It's not trying to define anything. It's not suddenly plummeting somewhere, plummet down. It's not untwist. It's not twisting. It's not angling. It's not trying to work some angle on anything. There's no angles to it. It's not pressing or pressurizing anything. No pressure, no pressing. It's not riotous. There's no sense of riotousness. It's not enervating. There's no sense of it's enervating, like, or it's tenuous or fragile or enervated. There's no, none of those qualities of like it might sort of just kind of attenuate away. No, it's not tenuous. It's not fragile. There's no fragility to true happiness, no fragility whatsoever. And it's not wilty, like you see flowers, a wilty flower. There's no wilting in true happiness whatsoever. There is no wilting at all. And you can come up with other characteristics as you see characteristics of this world. Just say, true happiness, that is not like true happiness. That's my thinking and valuing has delineated these qualities. But none of those qualities are actually my true quality, which is actually true, undefined happiness and freedom. So this is the real work that's done. Now, we talked about beautiful forms and how not to identify with them and to turn your attention away from them. This includes beautiful things, as well as beautiful music and art and culture and all that stuff too, actually. Through a lifetime of experience here in the world, I've basically guinea pigged myself to see what works and what doesn't. And I found out that when you attach your attention to any beautiful form, no matter how subtle it may be, the wheels come off. Eventually the wheels come off badly, badly. So it's way better to forego all the pomp and circumstances and the high culture and all that kind of stuff. It's better to get back to a more Puritan outlook as far as, look, put your attention in where it's safe to put it. And where I say it's safe to put it is continuity practice, is the safe place to put your effort and your attention. And it's a struggle, for sure it's a struggle. It's a struggle for me, it's a struggle for everyone. Because you think, oh, if I just added something beautiful, you know, it would enhance the situation. You know, it's like adding caffeine to a painkiller or something. You know, it's going to enhance the situation, or mixing drugs or some way to enhance the situation, enhance how you feel, make you even more attracted to the form. And what we try to do is, this, as you know, this whole world culture now is going toward, how do we enhance our experience of form? That's what they're thinking. How do we enhance our experience of form? That's why you have all these pills now, all these pills, right? In many different angles, it's all about how can we focus on and enhance our attachment to form, so we think our happiness is there, and so we don't look for our happiness where? In reality, which is what? God, which is what we have a conflict with, which is what we don't want to recognize, so we can honor our idea of trying to create separately from God. So we're trying to enhance our happiness with form, so we continue to be happy with form, so we continue to experience this conflict here in form, so we continue to think the conflict is here and not where it is. You see, it's a matrix, isn't it? It's a matrix. But we can break out of that matrix. Continuity practice is the way, is a very safe way to break out of it. It's not necessarily the only way. And we have to avoid exclusive statements in terms of practice or teachers or whatever, because that really brings about a lot of conflict and upset, actually. But what I like to say is the very safe way, a very safe and effective way to proceed. And so I recommend it. I recommend it, I promote it, I share it, and I'm trying to do it myself, is to keep the teaching dry, as I say, keep it dry, keep it unglamorous, keep it dressed down. Don't try and be happy, promote happiness towards form, form as a source of happiness. And at the same time, we don't have to be draconian about it, you know, entirely, but always take the side of, let's keep it simple, let's keep it safe, safe and simple. Here comes the leaf blower again. All right, some more silence. Now to promote the sobriety, the simple and safe way, I'm going to read a chapter from this book, Journey Beyond Words. Transcribed, the ideas of Jesus transcribed by Dr. Brent Haskell. And this will give you a good idea of the sobriety and clarity and effectiveness. Greetings again, I am Jeshua. I have come this day to further with you my discussion of A Course in Miracles. Last time I spoke with you about the leap of faith and how it was that you're valuing, rather, your release from valuing anything in this world would set you free. And how is it that your valuing is nothing more than the delineation of that which you believe yourself to be? Then I said that the leap of faith which you may take, indeed which you must take to free yourself from this world, is to come to the point where you can freely and joyfully say, I do not know. Now, For you to say, I do not know, is an extremely positive statement. It is a statement of such great freedom and of such great release that if you knew what joy it would bring you, you would move to and beyond that point in the twinkling of an eye. For when you say, I do not know, you are not, in fact, referring to your one self, world, to that which has created this world you think you see. So when you move to the point where you say, I do not know, what you are really saying is, and you can say it with celebration, I do know that this world is not myself. You are really saying, I do know I have an identity as the Son of God, which is beyond this world. Just a minute. Okay, so let me go over that last part again. This is real life. I got just a little interruption there. So when you move to the point where you say, I do not know, what you are really saying is, and you can say it with celebration, I do know that this world is not myself. You are really saying, I do know I have an identity as a Son of God which is beyond this world. You are really saying, I do know that to the extent that God is joy and peace and freedom, then so am I. So I want to emphasize for you that to say I do not know can and should be a thing of great joy unto you. For when you say I do not know, and realize as you say it, that this world has nothing whatsoever to do with what you truly are, then you may be assured as you say those words that you in reality are standing tall, spreading your wings and saying aloud, I am free. Now, it seems, for those of you who would still believe that this world, in some measure, does have something to do with what you are, that to say, I do not know, can be quite fearful. For as we have said, to say, I do not know, means that you must let go of that which you believe yourself to be, and if you do, it seems you would surely die. But I tell you, to say, I do not know, to say that this world cannot bring you to the knowledge of yourself, is indeed your freedom. For what happens in the instant when you realize within your being that you do not know, in that instant there comes the awareness of God. And all that keeps you, any of you, from the certainty of what you are as the Son of God is the valuing of this earth. Indeed, ultimately, your values are your statements that say, I do know. And in your valuing, what you are saying is, I believe that my thoughts are the creator of all that is. I believe that my thoughts and my perceptions have displaced those of God. I am sure when you see it this way, you can surely smile, as a parent would at a small child as he plays his silly games. You can indeed chuckle as you see yourself imagining that your thinking, with all its bonds, with all its fear, with all its misery, somehow supersedes and becomes instead the voice of God. It is as if a whisper could overcome the power of a hurricane. But as you whisper, I do know, because you are the Son of God, it is given that your whisper can, indeed, seem to you to overcome the mightiness of God. Your imagining that you do know can have such power for you, because that is the power you have as the Son of God. Rejoice in the awareness that your illusions can have such strength and such magnitude, for they are a reflection, albeit a tiny reflection, of the strength and magnitude of the reality of your one self. So your goal, then, is merely this: to cease the whispering, to cease the tiny voices that urge you to say, I do know, to let go of the value you place on the self, small self. You have defined in terms of this world, to let go of the value you place on the self, you have defined in terms of this world, and thereby to open to the mighty voice of God, which shall fill you with the awareness of what you truly are. So I have come to tell you this. If you can come to the point where, even in your thinking, even academically, you can say, I do not know, for I am the Son of God, That's speaking of the words, that academic understanding, which is not the reality of what you are, shall slowly seep into your being until one day the awareness, the certainty, and the experience beyond the words shall be yours. When you say, I do not know, you do not leave a vacuum which can remain empty. When you arrive at the point where you can take this leap of faith, you will find there is nothing to fear, for your tendency is to think that in not knowing you shall cease to exist. But I have come to tell you, with the entire love of the universe, there is no vacuum there. There is no ceasing to exist. There is only the immediate blossoming and awareness of your reality as the Son of God. That experience shall come perhaps in an instant. That shall be the moment in which your thinking passes into oblivion and your experience becomes what you are. You, in your power, can choose to have this take time if you do choose thusly. Do not make yourself wrong. Simply realize that it is your power as the Son of God that allows you to experience whatever you will, to take as much time as you wish, and even that realization shall bring you closer to the point where you can let it go, and in that instant, be free. So what am I really saying to you this day? I am saying to you, the prison of this earth, and prison it is the product, the representation of that which you value, even if it be that which you consider beautiful. Still, it creates your prison, for it shall pass away, and you shall grieve, and you must live in the fear of the time when it shall indeed pass away. Because God and real love cannot change. The things of this earth are not and cannot be of God. So as you let go of your valuing, know that it cannot be of God. You simply let go of that which binds you to this earth. And as I say, I do not know, as you say, I do not know, you are in reality when you can mean those words, smiling and laughing and spreading your wings of freedom. All it demands you do is spread your wings, and then the wind, which is your real nature as the Son of God, shall become a presence flowing beneath those wings, lifting you and carrying you without effort, high and higher and beyond, to a peace and to a joy and a peace and a knowing that you as yet cannot imagine. Hear me well. You shall be able to walk this earth for the remainder of the days you choose with wings unfolded and the breath of God being the wind beneath those wings, and a joy which shall lift you to the heavens of your mind will be yours moment to moment. The key that shall bring you that joy is your forgiveness. Forgiveness is your only function here. And remember that forgiveness is just your awareness that there is no value in this world, that there is nothing in this world which can speak to you of what you are. As you realize that what you are is beyond this world, you can rejoice as you say, I do not know. And before you finish the words, there shall come the breath of God beneath your wings. My brothers, let go of your values. Do not approach this with fear. Do not see the statement, I do not know, as negative. Rather, see it as your step to joy and a flight that shall take you to heavens beyond what you can even imagine. Blessings upon you all. That is all. So there you go. There you go. Straight from truth itself. Simple, clear, direct, hitting on all the points, awakening us to the safe and simple way. And God knows we certainly need that awakening to the safe and simple way during these times here. So we're just taking a little cool down here. Very powerful there, very powerful to speak those words. Very powerful experience. Because I certainly realize in reading it, what's being said there is true. It is true. So many facets there, you know, it's like looking at a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful diamond, metaphorically, and we don't want to look at beautiful diamonds because, as he said, even beautiful form, you know, you shall pass away and you shall grieve and believe that in your own death. But metaphorically, it's as if looking at a very, very, very beautiful diamond, so many facets are just like, wow. Now that's what's really beautiful, isn't it? That's content there. That's beautiful content we just listened to. Beautiful content. Meaning it has meaning. Meaning it relates us directly to what we are. And freedom from our valuing. So it has meaning. It's truly helpful. That's content for us at this, from where we're at with the continuity issue. That is content for us. That is food. And Jesus said, I have food not of this world, not for your body, but for your spirit. This is food for our spirit, which is a far different thing than the beautiful form, which is food for our senses, our eyes, sensory perception, right? This speaks to something beyond the senses, right? And the fact that we can register this means there is something beyond the senses. So I'm just going to enjoy this buzz from this, and I guess we'll wrap up this video. It's been a great video to do, and I feel a very positive one here. Touched on a lot of facets, which is what I want to do from now on, is really give that diamond, you know, faceted approach of very, you know, simple, safe and simple, but focusing on content, beautiful content. True content, okay? All right, very great. Appreciate everyone that watches here. That's it for the video.